Several years ago, as a lost man, I was involved in some things that I knew were wrong, and I had something that was very devastating happen to me during that time. And I went into a certain individual, and you know, most people these days don't have conversations like what I'm about to tell you. But I was crying and blubbering, and I just bore my soul to this individual. And he just didn't seem like he was very interested in what I was saying. And I got through talking to him, and he said, I'm going to pray that things get worse. And I just kind of blinked a few times. And he said, I love you. He said, there's no doubt that I love you. He said, but I'm going to pray that you are so miserable that you can barely breathe. And I was thinking to myself, well, that's kind of odd to tell somebody who's going through some trials. He said, let me tell you something. He said, you're not going to go against what the Bible says and come out ahead. He said, I've been telling you that your whole life, because this was a relative of mine. He said, but you're not going, and he said, if misery is what it takes to get you back on track, then I'm going to pray for misery. He said, I'm not going to take your hand and pray with you and hug on you. He said, that might come later. That might come later. He said, but right now, he said, what you need to do, he said, you just hadn't hit bottom yet. And the reason I'm telling you that story is because, see, it doesn't matter how big or how small or how rich you may be. You're not going to propagate a philosophy that's against Scripture. You're not going to be involved in a lifestyle. It's a lot, you know, everything's a lifestyle now. This lifestyle. No, it's not lifestyles. There's just right and wrong. That's all there is. And you're not going to go against the Scripture and come out ahead. And this thing with Israel now, this is serious business. Listen, I just got through taking the book of Revelation for our class. And that book is not for the faint of heart. But there are certain things that's going to kick all this off. And I'm not up here saying that it's the end times. No, that's none of my business. That's way above my pay grade to say when that's going to happen. But I am saying this. I'm saying that we can't listen. God's position referring to Israel in Scripture is overt. It's very easy to see. You don't have to dig for it. You're not going to take an aggressive position against Scripture, no matter who you are. I've got relatives. It really upsets me to talk about it. I've got relatives that dabble with alcohol. Listen, that is dangerous. That is insidious. That kind of thing can sneak into your life and get a hold of you. You say, why are you bringing this up? I'm just giving you examples. Church attendance, whatever. I'm giving you examples. Things that the Bible is very, because there are certain things that the Bible doesn't speak to specifically. But alcohol is something that the Bible speaks to specifically. And people want to act like it's one or two verses. No, it's all through the Bible. It's all through the Bible. And people want to take verses out of context, use a little wine for your stomach's sake and all that foolishness. It's all through the... You cannot ignore scriptural principles and come out okay. You can't do it. And what we're going to talk about this morning, once I let y'all talk a little bit with the Bible reading, what we're going to talk about this morning is a man named the Apostle Paul who prized the Bible above everything else. And not just the gospel of the Bible. The quote, lifestyle of the Bible, the principles of the Bible. Listen, if we follow the basic principles of Scripture. Now, nobody's perfect. Nobody does everything they ought to do. But if we follow the basic principles of Scripture, do you know that blessings and success will be inevitable? You won't be able to avoid. Now, life won't be easy, by the way. Life will not be easy. Life's hard if you're lost and on the wicked path. Life's hard if you're saved and on the good path. It's hard either way. But like the man said, the retirement plan when you're a Christian is awesome. It's out of this world. So, if we will say that we're going to abide by biblical principles, then blessings and success, to some extent or another, will be inevitable. Now, what I want to do at this time is to open the floor up. Brother Ron's got the mic. To those of you that want to share something that you have seen in the course of your Bible reading. Who's going to go first? Now, I know what y'all are going to do. Y'all are going to sit there until I say, all right, let's move on, and three hands are going to go up. So, Miss Kelly's going to start us off.
I'm waiting for somebody else. Now, I'm not all the way into Matthew now, but I have read Matthew and learned something in. I'm reading some in the Old and some in the New Testament. And I found that during the time period, 3 days, the time that Jesus died, there were 2 earthquakes. And I've read that hundreds of times, but it never hit my head that it was 2 different earthquakes, one the day that he died and one the day that he was risen.
There were 2 earthquakes?
Check it out. All right, check it out in Matthew 27:51 and Matthew 28:2.
I will certainly do that. I always thought it was just retelling the first one. But I'll... Listen, if you say there were 2 earthquakes, I'm not going to say anything any different. Because I haven't looked at it in a while. Yeah, it's not in the other 3 Gospels. See, Matthew doesn't give a... He doesn't give a whole lot of commentary on what happens. Matthew, whenever we studied the life of Christ, we did it through the book of Matthew. And now we brought in the other Gospels, but Matthew is an interesting Gospel. I had to look at that, Miss Kelly. That's interesting. Anyone else? You know, I talked last week about I didn't know there was 2 trees in the garden. I mean, there was much trees in the garden, but there were 2 that were significant. The tree of life and the tree of good and evil. Anyone else? Yes, sir, Brother Bill. Hold on, Brother Bill. He's got to get the mic to you.
Like reading in the Kings and places where it tells you that like Jehoshaphat and his might that he showed and how he warred, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the Kings of Judah? These books that they talk about, are they somewhere?
No, when he says the Chronicles of the Kings, he's talking about 1st and 2nd Chronicles.
Okay, so whatever they're talking about when they're written in certain books is the books in the Bible?
Yeah, well, it is in the case of 1st and 2nd Chronicles.
Okay, but there's other places too that talks about different books that what they did, other stuff that they did.
Yeah, those books didn't make it into the canon.
Okay.
They didn't make it into the canon.
So there's not a copy somewhere?
No, sir. Those books are not considered the generalized word for those books. Or I guess would be the Apocrypha. I don't know.
Okay.
There are copies, and a lot of theologians who know way more about this than I do. I say a lot. I'm not in a group of theologians, but a lot of theologians who know more about this than I do. You can read those books as history books. There are some of those books that I would like to read. They're good. They're good history books. They offer some commentary, but they're not considered inspired by the Holy Spirit. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. But when it says Chronicles, when it says the Chronicles of the Kings, that specifically is referring to 1st and 2nd Chronicles. Someone once told me that Kings gives God's point of view and Chronicles gives man's point of view. Or I've got it backwards. It's one of those. Do I got it backwards? So Chronicles gives God's point of view and Kings gives man's point of view. I got that wrong on a test because I always get it backwards. But Yes, sir. So, but when it mentions Chronicles, that's what it's talking about. But there are other books that are available, and there's, I mean, you're not going to turn to stone if you read them, but they're not considered inspired. As far as I know, they're not considered inspired. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Brother Donnell, had your hand up, sir?
Don't know exactly how to put it. There were official historical documents in Jewish history that were chronicles of the kings, and I think some of that matches Scripture. I mean, the accounts are the same.
Yes, sir.
So, a reference to the chronicles of the kings
may not necessarily be First or Second Chronicles. Is that what you're saying?
I'm suggesting that possibility.
Okay. Okay. Well, without going too far into it, my position, and I believe the position of everybody in here, if it's in a book of the Bible, it's inspired. Yeah. And if it's not, because I mean, and the reason I bring this up is because there are people who believe in levels of inspiration. And I forget all the technical names, but they're not important anyway. But there are those who believe that only the words of Christ are inspired. Only the words of Christ are inspired. There are those who believe that the poetical books are not inspired. But everything in this Bible is inspired. What I'm about to say is why we teach English in the Bible college. Because we ought to pay attention to the words of the Word of God. Because according to 2 Timothy, every word is inspired. See, a lot of people say, well, the ideas are inspired. The ideas and the events are inspired. I mean, but God let the authors, the human penmen, choose their own words. No, He didn't. Now, He did let them write through the prism of their own personality. Some writings are different than others, but every single word, all of the words within the Word of God is inspired. See, and I see some hands, and I'll get to you in just a second. Of course, I say that every single week, and I'll invariably miss somebody. But God, we have to remember that the Bible is a book. And when I say that, I don't mean it's any other book. Here's what I mean by that. God gave us the Bible by means of written revelation. And see, once you write something down in words, words have context. Words have context. A text without a context is a pretext. So we do need to bear in mind that the Bible is a book. Now, in the book of the Revelation, you'll have an angel flying around telling people the gospel for a period of time. We don't have that right now. We have this. And believers take our cues from this. So God didn't give one person the whole Bible all at one time. He gave it to an original audience. He gave them pieces of it. It progressed. That's called progressive revelation. So He gave it to us in a book, and books are made up of words, and words have context. And that is why the English language is so important, because this is God's Word for the English-speaking languages, for the English-speaking peoples of the world. It's the inspired Word of God. That's why words are important. Of course, I'm biased anyway. I have an English degree. I think that if you're going to, and I'm not saying you're not qualified to study and teach the Word of God if you don't have an English degree. It's not what I'm saying. I'm saying it helps. So we ought to be concerned about every single word in the Bible. I'm leery of these people that write these commentaries and say, well, a better translation is this. And a lot of good men that I respect do that on occasion. Listen, by the way, this does not override the Greek. I'm not the Greek or the Hebrew. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that the King James Bible is the preserved Word of God. That's what I'm saying. So everything in this book is inspired, and all the books that did not make it in this book, because, and by the way, we don't need to believe that a committee of men decided what was going to be in the Bible. That's not true. The Holy Spirit worked through those men, because there were various committees and councils that met. But what is in this book is the inspired Word of God, and what is not in this book, while it may be great history, Brother Bill, and I've read some of it, and I don't say that we should, but we should not count it on the same par with the Bible. I've read a lot of good books. I've read after some great men, but those men aren't on par with this. All right, Brother Joe Jones, and then Brother Donnell.
Well, it's possible to read a lot of different Bibles, a lot of information from various sources, and just kind of spoil your mind to a certain point. But according to the Scripture, you know, you refer to it, 2 Timothy 3:16.
Yeah.
All Scripture is by inspiration of God, is profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, instruction, and righteousness. We know that as you study the verbal plenary, as God breathed, we know that it came from God. We know, according to 2 Peter, that is, 1:21, for the prophecy came not in old times by the will of man, but by holy men of God speak as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. We also know that even though if you're not grounded in the Word of God, it's very possible to be swayed and believe a lie. If you can't discern what the truth is, because you just don't quite have it. You have to be very careful that you don't stray too far from the Bible while you're reaching out there studying other things. Thank you.
Yes, sir. It can be a dangerous thing to read other manuscripts and other documents if you're not grounded in Scripture. We need to make sure that we're not susceptible to what the Bible calls every wind of doctrine. Brother Donnell?
Going back to your emphasis on every word, our key text for a major part of our introduction of the Bible course, which we go through here every now and then, Psalm 12:6-7. The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified seven times. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever.
Yes.
And we see in Acts chapter 2, he's able to do that even through what would otherwise be the barrier of translation.
Yes, sir, certainly. Okay, on that note, speaking of what we should and should not teach and preach, for the last few minutes, open your Bibles, if you would, to the book of Acts, chapter 17. No, I'm not in the book of Acts in my Bible reading. I wish that I were, but I'm certainly not in the book of Acts. But there are some interesting things here. This is one of Paul's most prominent sermons. The longest sermon he ever preached was in the second half of Acts 13. He preached at Pisidian Antioch, and that was the longest sermon that he preached. But this is certainly one that's talked about the most, or one of the most talked about sermons. I've never really understood the relationship with Acts to the epistles, but Acts gives the events and the epistles give the commentary, and I didn't really understand that. I've always kind of taught the epistles as a standalone thing, but one of the most rewarding things that I've encountered is studying the book of Acts. I say, every time I finish a course, I say that. I guess it should all be rewarding, but let's look at Acts 17 a little bit. I just want to know where I want to start here. Verse 15. Yeah, verse 11, talking about those that, you know, they got in some trouble at Thessalonica, but the people at Berea were more noble because they had a desire for the Word of God. But sticking with the Acts account, and they conducted Paul, brought him into Athens, and receiving a commandment unto Silas and Timotheus for to come to him with all speed, they departed. Now while Paul waited for them in Athens, so they're in Macedonia. If you study that, they're in Macedonia. Of course, you don't have to study. It's a few verses above what I'm reading. His spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. Now, it's been said, and Brother Rowan talked about this either last week or the week before, but it's been said that there were more gods in Athens than people. There was a god for everything in Athens. There's another verse that I can't find. It says he was pressed in the spirit, and here it says he was stirred. But when it says he was pressed, I believe that's when he's in Corinth. When it says he was pressed in the spirit, what that means is that he was preoccupied with evangelism. He couldn't get his mind off of telling people about Jesus. Now, those of us today, we're preoccupied with a lot of other things. Monday night, I went over to my mom's to watch a football game, and she made dinner, and I got over there and they didn't have ESPN. And I said, "Well, Mama," I said, "I'm gonna have to leave." I said, "I want to watch the game, and you don't have ESPN." So we ended up calling, and I said, "Mama," I said, "I need you to get on the phone and ask them if I can order ESPN right now." And so she got on the phone with him, and we got ESPN ordered, and we sit over there for the next 4 hours to watch Alabama lose with 6 seconds left on the clock. But my point is, I was preoccupied. Listen, the boys would come in, and I'd say, "Go talk to your mama, because they won't." But we get preoccupied with a lot of things in life. But can you imagine being preoccupied with telling people about Jesus? That really because can you imagine if everything that we did in life was so, "I need to get this done"? You know, you got to work a job, you got to pay bills. You know, but if we had the attitude that "I've got to get this done so I can go tell somebody about Jesus." Well, and here it says that his spirit was stirred within him. He was provoked to tell these people about Jesus. Therefore, now notice that, so because the whole city is given over to idolatry, on that basis is what "therefore" means. For that reason, the old saying is, if you see the word "therefore," you ought to look and see what it's there for. But "therefore disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons and in the market daily with them that met with him." The word "disputed" means to have a discussion, a lively discussion, a debate. Now look at verse 18. "Certain philosophers of the Epicureans and of the Stoics encountered him. And some said, 'What will this babbler say?'" Now that's an interesting word, because that word "babbler," that word "babbler" means to pick up insignificant things. It has to do with a bird picking up seed. And it means to gather insignificant things. So what they're saying is that his information is insignificant. And "other some," look at the middle of 18, "other some, he seemeth to be a setter forth of strange gods." So Paul here is accused of talking about strange gods. Well, let's see who he's talking about. "Because he preached unto them Jesus and the resurrection." Now, they've got all, and see, that's what's ironic here. is they've got all these gods that actually are strange. That's what's ironic here. They've got all these gods here that actually are strange. But they're calling his God strange. Doesn't Isaiah talk about calling evil good and good evil? Talks about having things out of whack and mixed up and upside down. So obviously here, obviously Paul has to realize they don't know anything about Christ. They don't know anything about God. Their only idea of the resurrection was this God they had who was the God of restoration. See, that they believed that the body was the prisoner of the soul. Why would anybody come back in a resurrected body? Listen, that's a demotion. Because anything that's material is inherently wicked. And the only perfect thing is the spirit. The only perfect thing are things within the spirit realm. So why would anybody come back in a resurrected body or a glorified body? So obviously here they're all confused. And see, the Epicureans, they believed that the only true goal in life, the paramount goal in life, was pleasure. And there was no final judgment. That's what they believed. The Stoics, they were like Brother Donnell. He's a real Stoic guy. He didn't. That's where the word comes from. They didn't let a lot get to him. Like Brother Rowan. They were, you know, you shouldn't let things bother you. You just take things. And now they weren't. Now Brother Donnell and Brother Rowan, they're not like the Stoics as far as religiously. They were the Stoics were what's the word? Pantheistic. They were pantheistic. They were rational beings. Religion was irrational. But the word Stoic comes from, if you say, well, he's a real Stoic guy, the way we use it these days, you're not talking about religion, you're talking about personality. Because I am the exact opposite of Stoic. If that tells you what Stoic means, I'm not laid back at all. So and they accuse him of being a babbler. They accuse him of being a babbler. And they call the true God strange. But so, and let's see what happened. And they took him and brought him to Areopagus, saying, may we know what new doctrine whereof thou speakest is. For thou bringest certain strange things to our ears. We would know what these things mean. Now, it would sound like they were truly searching. It would sound like that. And maybe some of them were as individuals, but as a group, they were not truly searching. You say, how do you know that, Brother Paul? Look at the next verse. For all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear some new thing. See, they had all these gods. And in a minute, we're going to find out that they made an altar to the unknown God. So like Brother Owen said a couple of weeks ago, they say, okay, we got all these gods, but just in case we miss one, we're going to build an altar to the unknown God. See, they just wanted to add this to their pantheon of beliefs. What Brother Dewey's always said about these guys is these guys need to go out and get a job. That's what he always said. They need to go out and get a job. So now Paul has to know. Now I'm making a point here, and I'm not going to have time to cover it all, but I'm making a point here because now Paul knows they don't know anything about Christ. They don't know anything about the God of the Bible. So does he change what he preaches? Once he finds this out, does he try to meet them on their level and start talking about the elements of Greek philosophy, which he could have done, by the way. He could have started talking about the moral argument. The moral argument states that because all men everywhere in every society who's ever existed on the planet, every culture on the planet for all of human history has had some paradigm or version of morality. All of them. And if that's true, then someone has to be dictating to them what morality is. He could have talked about the truth argument. Because we have truth and we have falsehoods, somebody's got to be deciding what truth is. He could have started discussing all these Greek philosophies. He could have talked about that the idea that if something goes from simple to complex, if a simple being goes to a complex being, somebody's got to be controlling it. Listen, he knew all these things. Paul was a highly educated individual, perhaps the most educated person to be involved in Scripture. But he didn't do that. He did not change his method. He did not change his message to meet them on their level. Let's see what he talked about. We're going to skip down a little bit because we just don't have time to deal with it all. Go down to verse 24. God that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is worshipped with man's hands as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things, and hath made of one blood, and hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed and the bonds of their habitation. So let's just bounds of their habitation. So let's stop in here for a minute. We only got a few minutes. But verse 24, do you know what verse 24 is in complete accordance with? Genesis chapter 1. He's talking here about the Creator God. See, he doesn't say, they don't know anything about Jesus. They don't know anything about God. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to just appease them and meet them on their level. Here's what I mean by that, because we do have to be careful where we start with somebody in the Bible. That's absolutely true. You have to be careful where you start with somebody in the Bible. You probably aren't going to start in the book of the Revelation. There's nothing wrong with the book of the Revelation. That's inspired. But we do have to be careful where we start with someone in the Scripture. But the Bible needs no support. The Bible needs no support. You had philosophers like Thomas Aquinas who believed that the Bible was a capstone of reason. So in other words, you build this pyramid. You build this pyramid of intellect, intellectual reasoning, and philosophy, and secular ideas. You explain all that, and then you set the Bible on top of that. The Bible's not a capstone. The Bible is not a capstone of intellectual reasoning. Listen, the Bible can stand on its own. And we know that because of how Paul dealt with these people. He teaches them the God, the Creator God. He deals with the doctrine of man. If you look down, he deals with the doctrine of God. He says he's the Creator. Verse 24. Verse 23, or verse 25 rather, he is condemning their idolatry. He's condemning their idolatry. If you look at verse 25, look at verse 25, and you look at verse 25 and verse 29. He's condemning their idolatry. So he's teaching about the Creator God. He's condemning their idolatry. And in verse 26, he's saying, hey, we're all one blood. See, the Greeks thought they were something special. Listen, this bloody religion was kind of pedestrian to them. They thought they were something special. So Paul's saying, wait a minute. He's saying we're all one blood. And look at the last part of verse 26. Look at the last part of verse 26. And hath determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation. Look at verse 27. That they should seek the Lord. He said the reason he put you here was to seek him. There's no reason to worship an unknown God, because the God of heaven wants to be known. He wants to be known. He wants to be understood. That they should seek the Lord, if happily they might feel after Him and find Him, though He be not far from every one of us. So God wants to be found. Why do you have an altar to the unknown God? He wants to be found. He wants to be known of you. But here, and here's what I want to get to. And I've only got a couple of minutes left. But a lot of people say that in verse 28, he's validating Greek philosophy. He's not doing that. He's not doing that. He is taking something they understand. He's taking something they understand and using it to validate Scripture. Look what he says. For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poets have said. For we are his offspring. There was and Brother Owen brought this out a couple of weeks ago. There was a poet called Euripides. His name was, and Paul's saying, yeah, what he says is right. For in him we live and move and have our being. You know why I know that's right? Because God created the earth. God created the earth. And yeah, they had another poet named Aratus, I believe it is. And he said, yeah, we're God's offspring because he created us. So he's taking something. So he is here in effect taking something they would understand. He's taking something they would understand, and he's saying but he's not agreeing with everything those poets say. He is taking those specific lines of poetry and using it to prove Scripture. Now look at this. So we've seen the doctrine of God. We've seen the doctrine of man. We're all one blood. We're all in need of a Savior. Don't think that this salvation is beneath you. But we're not through yet, and I'm going to do this in about 30 seconds. Look at verse 30. And the times of ignorance God winked at. That means he was more tolerant. He passed over it, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent. So we have the doctrine of God. We have the doctrine of man. We have repentance. Repentance is a change of mind. When you change your mind about what you think is valuable in God's eyes, all this worship is not valuable. All these gods are not valuable. He's already condemned their idolatry. And the Creator God goes right along with Genesis 1:1. When he talks about he can't dwell in temples, that goes right along with 1 Kings 8:27. Look at this. Look at verse 31. But he hath appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness. By who?
That man.
By that man. By that man. Judge the world in righteousness by that man, whereof he hath given whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men. Notice this now. He's given assurance unto all men in that he hath raised him from the dead. So their ignorance that they're claiming, is it real? Not according to Romans 1. It's willful. Not according to Romans, not according to this verse. So now we have the doctrine of Christ. Now he didn't start with the virgin birth. He didn't start with the virgin birth. That's not what they needed. But within this message right here, you have the doctrine of God, you have the doctrine of man, you have the doctrine of Christ, and you have repentance, a change of mind toward what you think is valuable, what you think God will accept, and what He actually will accept. And the same man that's going to judge them is the same man that offers salvation. The same man that's going to judge them, that man, which goes right along with Psalms 96:8 and a bunch of other verses. But his whole argument here is biblical. My point is this, and I know I've gone a little bit over. My point is this. We don't have to change our message. We don't have to change our methods. Now, again, you do have to be careful where you start with someone in Scripture. But the Bible doesn't need any support. The Bible does not need, okay, once I lay the foundation of intellectual reasoning and philosophy, then I'll bring in Scripture. It's not what Paul does here. And that's not what we should do. And this is why it's so important to know the Word of God, because he met them where they were, as it were. He met them where they were, but he never ceased to give them a biblical argument. And that's what we should do. And that, again, is why we have, every year, a Bible reading revival. I'm going to ask Brother Gret Smallwood, if you would, sir, to stand and close us in prayer.